So it's a really great pleasure to be able to introduce Madhu Hegde here this evening. So Rachel actually did write up some notes because she was really excited about having you come. And so I'll try to touch on most of what she wrote, although I disagree with one of the things she wrote, so I have to not mention that. So I'll get to that in a minute. So a little bit about Manu's background. So he received his MD, PhD at UCSF in Vishwanath Lingappa's group, where he actually started working on membrane protein targeting to the ER, co-translational protein folding there. And he sort of, that's this aspect of quality control, which actually began with his work at UCSF, is a theme that he's continued throughout his career. He went from UCSF to the NIH to start his own independent group, quickly rose through the ranks to become a full investigator there. And then in 2011, he moved to the MRC, and that was a big loss for us in the United States. And he's done very well there. He's had fabulous discoveries that he's made. Here's where I disagree with Rachel. This includes structural biology, which Rachel considers an afterthought for some reason, but it really is sort of the culmination of the fact that Manu's group has done a lot of really difficult work reconstituting difficult biochemical problems in protein folding and quality control mechanisms. And that beautiful work is the reason that we wanted to invite Manu here this evening. He's won many awards, and we recognize him here tonight as well. And for those of you who've attended this meeting in the past, you know we use these keynote lectures as a way to bring in exciting scientists, including those who haven't been part of our community. And Manu, we hope you really enjoy your time here this week and that you will make this meeting part of your yearly schedule. So welcome.
Well, thank you, Jamie, for the introduction. Thanks actually to all the organizers for having me here. As Jamie said, this is my first time at this conference. And when I first got the invitation to come, my first thought was, of course, I was very excited. My second thought was, they surely must have mistaken me for Venki. then after I got over that, my third thought actually was a considerable amount of fear, because I'm not actually a part of the translation field, and this is something very new for me. And so hopefully I have something to contribute to this area, and I'll tell you about some of our recent work. The area that my lab actually works primarily in is the issue of how proteins in the cell get organized among the different compartments of the cell. And in particular, we know that cells typically have millions of proteins that they're making every minute, and these proteins have to somehow get to the correct parts of the cell. And so, for example, proteins have to get to the ER, which is the area that we've primarily worked on, but also they have to stay in the cytosol where they might assemble or fold and get to other compartments. And how this actually is accomplished is a tremendous feat, and this has been an area of a considerable amount of work in cell biology, and as I said, we've been working on how proteins get to the ER. Now, along the path of trying to understand how biosynthetic processes work, we noticed that actually a lot of times these processes are prone to failure. So for example, proteins might fail getting to the ER, and we've worked on trying to identify factors that recognize these failed products and target them for degradation. And this general area of quality control, how you identify very infrequent errors or failures in a process, what the factors are that mediate this recognition and how that actually works is something that actually we're very interested in. And so what I'll tell you about today is some work in which the failure occurs at the ribosome itself, where the ribosome fails to complete synthesis of a protein. And I'm going to focus specifically on how the cell manages to recognize that something has gone wrong and target these ribosomes for downstream processes, for example, degradation of the partially synthesized protein. And it's really this issue of recognition that I'm most interested in part because that's the crux of quality control. If you can't tell right from wrong, then quality control just doesn't work. And failures in quality control are increasingly associated with neurodegeneration and aging, and so this is a problem that we're very keen to understand. So one of the tricks that's used in the field that I come from is to make intermediates in translation. So for example, you can take an in vitro translation extract, and if you program this extract with the mRNA that's truncated in the middle of the coding region, what happens is that the ribosome will synthesize to the end of that mRNA, and it will stop there. And we typically call these ribosome nascent chain complexes. And this, for example, can be used to study interactions with factors that are recruited at this particular point in synthesis, or at later points, for example, this is how the presence of a translocation channel in the membrane was discovered and characterized. And so this trick basically allows you to look at intermediates by stalling these ribosome complexes. And so some years ago, we thought that we could use this trick to study quality control. And the idea was, if we took one of these stalled ribosome nascent chain complexes, we could then release it synchronously with puromycin in the presence of cytosol, and then see if that polypeptide that got released got ubiquitinated. And the idea was to try to figure out what components in the cytosol might recognize a protein that misfolded. And this just provided a way to synchronize this reaction and study the process. So when we did this experiment, it worked actually reasonably well. So the first lane is the initial translation product, where we have a tRNA-associated product. Some of it gets hydrolyzed during the electrophoresis. And then we did two reactions. The third lane is with puromycin. So the tRNA, of course, gets hydrolyzed and gets shifted to this lower product. And then you see these faint bands here, which turn out to be ubiquitination. So if you do a ubiquitin pull-down, you get these ubiquitinated products. But the control reaction is the one that's in the middle, where we just incubated it in the presence of cyclohexamide so that nothing else could happen. And Karina Vanden Malsberg, who was doing these experiments, noticed that at the top of the gel, there was this smudge, right? So this is the kind of thing that you ignore, which we did for a long time. And we didn't believe that this was actually ubiquitinated, even though it was pulled out with anti-ubiquitin pull-downs, because it just seemed like aggregates at the top of the gel. But we did many, many controls, and we convinced ourselves this was ubiquitinated. And in fact, that ubiquitinated product, if you analyze it on a sucrose gradient, cofractionates in the ribosomal fractions. So what seemed to be happening was that the polypeptide, when it just stays on the ribosome, was getting ubiquitinated. And we did a bit of characterization of this, and it turns out that this ubiquitination reaction is K48 linked for the aficionados of the proteasome field. It doesn't care what the substrate is. So you can have a folded protein or an unfolded protein. It was just getting ubiquitinated regardless. You could stall the mRNA by any of several ways. So for example, we use the truncated method because it's very straightforward, but if you stall it at hard to decode codons or with a stem loop in the mRNA, you still got this. And as I already mentioned, the tRNA remained attached. Now, at this point, you might say, look, everything is getting ubiquitinated. I mean, we were basically not going to study this because there was no negative control here. But then we did a bit of reading, and this is always useful to do. And it turns out that in the translation field, of course, you have the canonical steps of initiation, elongation, and termination. But people had studied what happens in unusual circumstances when, for example, ribosomes stall in the middle of translation. And work from Roy Parker and Harry Dietz's lab had characterized stalled translation as a trigger for degradation of mRNA. So this was these mRNA surveillance pathways. And then more recently, of course, these ribosomes that are stalled, that are highlighted in yellow, have to be recycled. And Rachel Green and Tatiana Pestova's lab had characterized the process of recycling the subunits. And then when we did a bit more reading, some work from Toshi Inada had noticed that the polypeptide that's partially synthesized seemed to be degraded. And all of this makes sense because, of course, you don't want these products to be lingering around in the cytosol. You're tying up ribosomal subunits. You're making aberrant partially synthesized proteins. These mRNAs are clearly defective. And the mechanism by which many of these processes work wasn't really understood, but it had been reasonably well characterized. And so what we realized was that we had this in vitro system. Now, the one thing that was known about how the protein gets degraded was in this really terrific paper from Claudio Jazero. And what Claudio showed was that when you get stalling on a poly-A sequence, and this is in yeast, somehow that ribosome that's stalled seems to recruit a ubiquitin ligase called listerin, or LTN1, in yeast. And that seems to be required for ubiquitination. So that was really the first molecular clue as to how this polypeptide might get degraded. And the reason Claudio was inspired to try to study this was because he had earlier shown that a spontaneously arising mutant in mice called a Lister mouse, because the mouse lists when it walks, develops neurodegeneration, and he wanted to understand what the gene product was, and that turns out to be this ubiquitin ligase. So we then were motivated to then see if our in vitro system was actually recapitulating any aspect of this pathway. And this was anything from obvious when we were doing this. So we had our stalled ribosome nascent chain, but we needed a way to stage the reaction so that we could dissect the individual steps. And we initially took a very simplistic approach. So if you do a time course of translation of a truncated mRNA, what you see is that the product gets synthesized first, and then there's a 10-minute lag or so before it gets ubiquitinated, okay? And so what we reasoned was that you could take an early time point, right? You immediately harvest that sample, isolate those stalled ribosome nascent chains that are not yet ubiquitinated, and then you can do things like add cytosol and see if it then gets ubiquitinated. And the idea was to dissect what happens. So we do this, and we learned a number of different things. And the first thing we learned, actually, is that you don't need cytosol at all. So again, the control reaction was actually the most informative. You add only the E1, E2, ubiquitin, and ATP, and the polypeptide was getting ubiquitinated. And then we do a few more experiments, and it turns out the ubiquitin active population was not an intact ADS, but actually a 60S. So that 60S subunit still had the polypeptide in it, and so what we could conclude is it must already have an E3 ligase bound to it, and all you really needed to add in this reaction was the E1 and E2 enzymes, along with ubiquitin and ATP. And so then we went back and did a bit more reading, and it turns out, as I mentioned briefly, work from Rachel Green and Tatiana Pestova had characterized this process of ribosome recycling. So there are a set of splitting factors that split the subunits, and the idea was that perhaps the splitting reaction is what generates the product that recruits the ubiquitination factors. Now, it could have been the other way around. It could be that the ubiquitin occurs first, and then you split the subunits, but the reason it's in this direction is because the biochemistry had told us already that these factors are involved in the splitting reaction, and we could deplete one of them, for example, HBS1, and that prevented splitting and it prevented ubiquitination. So the other way you can inhibit this at the very first step is to use a dominant negative inhibitor, a mutant of HBS1. So it turns out that HBS1 and pelota are homologs of eukaryotic release factors. So HBS1 is a GTPase that's homologous to ERF3, and pelota is homologous to ERF1. And you can make a GTPase deficient mutant, it will bind the ribosome, but it won't progress further, and you can trap this intermediate. So Susan Chow, who's the one that started at this point, trapped this intermediate and was able to, in fact, purify the ADS complex. So our nascent protein is radioactively labeled, so it allows us to follow what's going on, and then you get this beautiful ADS ribosomal complex. And you could then take that purified ADS, add it to cytosol, and the rest of the reaction proceeds, and you could show that if you depleted this ubiquitin ligase listerin from the cytosol, then ubiquitination didn't occur. So this provided very direct evidence that listerin was involved in ubiquitination of this nascent chain. And Susan then went ahead and purified the splitting factors and this ubiquitin ligase listerin, and then tried to get this reaction to work with purified factors. And I will say that initially, these experiments totally didn't work. And it was because of the detergent that was used in the listerin purification and so on. But eventually, you could kind of see something. But to really get it to work, what you had to do was to include a factor called EIF6. And we learned this when we read the splitting papers very carefully, because it turns out that when the ribosome subunits get split, they immediately rejoin. And to actually get these splitting assays to work, you have to include a factor that prevents the rejoining. And so this is completely an artificial, it's a real protein, but it's totally artificially used in this system to just prevent this rejoining reaction. And when you prevent that, then you get this beautiful ubiquitination, right? It occurs in minutes. And so this then tells us what the minimal components are here for this minimal ubiquitination system. It, of course, directly demonstrates that listerine is the ligase that mediates ubiquitination of the nascent chain, and it seems like more or less the problem looks in hand. Now, this was at the time when cryo-EM was just starting to get really powerful, and Rebecca Voorhees in my lab kept suggesting that we look at these by cryo-EM. And initially, we thought, what we thought we might do is just mix ribosomes with this listerine. But of course, that totally would have failed. And thankfully, we didn't try that experiment. What we did was, after we had reconstituted the whole pathway, we then took this reaction, put it on grids, and then looked at the structure. And this is a very modest resolution structure, and it was really our very initial look at what's going on. But what you're looking at in gray here is the 60S subunit. This is the exit tunnel where the protein would be coming out. And you could really only make out two main conclusions. One is that there was this extra density that we could assign to listerine, and part of it is near the exit tunnel. So that makes sense, because that's where ubiquitination has to occur. And of course, you could see EIF6 here. But the other key thing was that this is where the 40S would be. And you can see that the position of the listerine clashes with the 40S. So that tells you why this ligase has specificity for 60S and not 80S. And it explained a really important puzzle, which is, as I mentioned at the beginning, this issue of specificity. How do you specifically ubiquitinate the nascent chains on stalled ribosomes and not ones that are actively translating, even though the actively translating ones are probably a thousandfold more abundant? And the answer turns out to be that the ligase sits in a way where it clashes with an intact 80S ribosome. So that's at least part of the answer. But of course, it's not also rosy. We had to use that trick to prevent 40S rejoining. So that was clearly a problem. We're missing something, right? And the whole complex, this complex was very unstable. So if you for example, run this on a sucrose gradient, the listerine doesn't co-fractionate, even though it clearly associates and mediates ubiquitination. So what were we missing? And the answer actually came from genetic studies that were done and published at about the time we were doing these experiments, where we ran the reaction in complete cytosol, then we affinity purified the products and did mass spec, and of course you get listerine, you actually get all the splitting factors, and you get CDC48, which is a AAA ATPase involved in this pathway, but a top hit, as abundant as listerine, is a protein called NEMF. And as I mentioned, this had come up in some really nice genetic studies, one from Jonathan Weissman's lab and one from Micheline Fromont-Racine's lab, that had identified components involved in this pathway in yeast. And this protein NEMF is homologous to a protein that was originally called TAE2 and now called RQC2. And it suggested that then this component is somehow involved in this pathway. And we, of course, had a biochemical system to understand how it was working. So what Susan did was she then put NEMF into our with the rest of our purified components in the system. And what she sees is faster and more processive ubiquitination. So I'm just showing you, for simplicity, a single lane at an early time point from a time course. And in the first lane, you don't have NEMF in the system. And in the second one, you have NEMF. And ubiquitination is more processive and faster. And so you get higher number of ubiquitin chains attached. Now, importantly, if you then isolate the ribosomes from these reactions, the listerine, which is present at equal amounts in both reactions, can co-sediment with ribosomes only in the sample that has NEMF. And the other important point is that in the reaction with NEMF, we don't have to use that EIF6 trick to prevent subunit rejoining. So these biochemical experiments tell us that NEMF somehow inhibits 40S reassociation. That's why I've drawn it here at the interface. And that it somehow recruits and stabilizes listerine on the ribosome 60S. So the listerine somehow must make a contact. And at this point, we then analyzed again this purified, reconstituted system by cryo-EM. And you can see that listerine is where we saw it previously, but it interacts with NEMF. And NEMF is at the inter-subunit interface. So that tells us why it prevents subunit rejoining and why it stabilizes listerine on the ribosome. Again, this is just a low-pass filtered image, but at the key places where the interactions occur, one could get to atomic or near-atomic resolution, so one could build atomic models. And that was important because very similar architecture was found in studies from Adam Frost's lab and Claudio Jazera's lab working with Bridget Carriger, where they had pulled the complexes out of yeast, and in particular, yeast mutants that couldn't ubiquitinate. And so they saw the very similar architecture, but the one advantage we had is we actually had atomic resolution at the key interactions, and we had a biochemical system to test all of these things. So I'm not going to go through the data, but what we could show is that certainly the NEMF interacts with the tRNA that's here, and that tells us why it can engage only 60S complexes that have a nascent protein in them. And this is important because, of course, there are plenty of 60S floating around the cell, but you don't want this ligase to get recruited to these dummy 60Ss. You only want them recruited to ones that have a polypeptide, and it uses the tRNA as a proxy for that. The second thing is it explains specificity, because not only do you need the tRNA, but it also binds to the ribosome. So you get this avidity effect where it doesn't get competed by all the free tRNA that's present in the cell. And we could show this because you only get competition when you add about a thousandfold excess free tRNA. So even though the cell is swimming with all of the components for recognition here, intact ribosomes, 60S, tRNA, it's essentially coincidence detection that allows specific recruitment of these complexes here. And so the model that one could then come up with is that when this ribosome gets split, it exposes a unique surface, in particular the tRNA that recruits NEMF, and it's stabilized by essentially an interaction with the P stalk of the ribosome, which actually moves out of the way. And when it moves out of the way, it makes a nice binding site for Lystrin, which gets recruited. So we can have this sequence of events that explains, at least to a reasonable approximation, why you get specificity of a ligase that at least has a binding site on the ribosome, but it doesn't ubiquitinate intact ribosomes. Now, this was actually fairly satisfying, but if you actually think about it, we haven't really addressed the problem I wanted to address, which is we've worked out these downstream components, but we still don't really know how the cell knows when a ribosome has stalled, right? And clearly, this reaction here is mediated by those splitting factors, and so somehow they have to recognize when a ribosome has stalled, was the idea. Now, at this point, Susan teamed up with Alan Brown in Venki Ramakrishnan's lab, and we also worked with Jack Taunton's group to try to get structures of different steps in translation. And what they were able to do, and I'm just going to summarize this in a simple cartoon, is they were able to stall, using the same biochemical tricks in the in vitro system, intermediates during elongation, so the amino acyl tRNA bound to EEF1A, an intermediate in termination at the stop codon, and an intermediate during recycling using ribosomes that are trapped in different ways. And essentially, the key point here is that the rescue factors, the pelota HBS1 that are responsible for recycling the subunits, this is a truncated message, so there's nothing in the A site, and you can see that it protrudes into where the RNA would sit in the A site of the ribosome. So what this tells us is that in the very simple case where the ribosome is truncated, the pelota HBS1 can recognize this because in the other cases, there are other factors that are far more abundant, and they don't have the steric issue of tRNA of mRNA in the A site. And so this at least explains how these relatively low abundance factors can recognize a stalled ribosome, but only in the case where it's truncated. What we know is that, in fact, ribosomes stall for many other reasons. In fact, it's likely that this is a very unusual instance. And in these cases, there's mRNA in the A site. In many cases where, for example, it's stopped at in the poly A tail, there are EEF1A tRNA complexes that would be competing. So it was totally unclear how these factors might engage that. And I don't have an answer for you, but I will say that if you, in a biochemical system, have only the pelota HBS1, it can bind and it can displace the mRNA that's in the A site, and it can split. It just works slower. And that's an artificial system because there's no competitor. So the solution that the cell has to come up with is how do you then stall a ribosome in such a way that these things that are normally vastly outcompeted can actually have enough time to act and split these stalls, right? And we have a few clues. So there was work from a number of years ago from Carol Deutsch's lab that showed that when the ribosome is translating basic amino acids, so for example, if you translate a poly A tail, for example, if the mRNA is not processed properly, AAA codes for lysine. But any basic amino acid, what the Deutsch lab showed, seems to slow down translation. And what they speculate with reasonably good evidence is that there's electrostatic interactions inside the ribosomal tunnel, which is primarily negatively charged, and the basic residues in the polypeptide. More recently, Rachel Green's lab has shown that in vitro reconstituted systems, the ribosome, the translation system has a very difficult time decoding runs of AAA codons. So for example, the second AAA codon in a dye codon such as this is decoded much slower than the first one is. And although the exact details of why that's the case are unclear, we have two mechanisms by which you can slow down translation at the points where you eventually want to recognize something has gone wrong. But slowing things down isn't quite enough, right, to get these factors to split these subunits. And there was genetic studies that suggested that that wasn't the entire story, because work in Jonathan Weissman's lab showed that there are factors which, when deleted, allow the ribosome to translate through sequences that would have stalled. And so the experiment here is they have reporters where there's a GFP and an RFP separated by a polybasic sequence. I believe a run of arginines in this case. And what they see is that in wild-type cells, you get very little GFP because the ribosomes stall and that front bit gets degraded by the ribosome quality control pathway, and you get very little RFP because the ribosomes stall and you never translate these downstream sequences. So that's down here. This is, again, just simulated from there. I just scanned in their thing and showed only the relevant data points. So if you delete Listerin, now you get GFP. That's because the front end doesn't get degraded, but of course you still can't translate and make the back end. But if you delete this protein called HEL2, you actually get both GFP and RFP. And what that tells you is that in the absence of this gene, you wind up being able to read past what is otherwise an obstruction. And so HEL2 turns out to be a ubiquitin ligase. And this intrigued us. And we were, of course, working in the mammalian system, so we first wanted to see if this was going to work in mammals. So first we needed to set up an assay. And so we just modified their assay in a couple of key ways, in which we insulated the GFP and RFP by viral 2A sequences. So these are sequences which, when the ribosome translates through them, it fails to make a peptide bond, and this polypeptide is released from the ribosome, but the ribosome continues on. So what you basically get when you translate a message that looks like this is you get three polypeptides, the GFP, your middle bit here, which is just a flag-tagged reporter that we have, and an RFP at the end. And the advantage of this is that the GFP and RFP, after they've been synthesized, are not subject to any quality control or anything. So the ratio of GFP to RFP tells you how often you terminally stall in the middle sequence. And if you stall, so here in this test sequence, if you put a run of something that causes ribosomes to stall, for example, poly A, so we put 21 AAA codons, what happens is the ribosomes will stall there. You'll synthesize the GFP and this reporter sequence, but that reporter sequence gets degraded by the ribosome-associated quality control. And we can show that using knockouts of NEMF, for example. But you don't make the RFP. So that's very easily assayed in single cell resolution using flow cytometry. So if you don't have that stalling sequence, you get a one-to-one ratio of GFP to RFP, but if you put poly A there, you get mostly GFP, but very little RFP. And so you can just plot that as a histogram of ratios, and you get a roughly equal ratio when there's no stalling sequence and a very low amount of the RFP when you have the poly A. Okay, so now, this is Shimon Yuskevich, who's now doing these experiments, looks for a homolog for HEL2 in mammals. And there's a very weak homolog. It's about 15% identical. And he then knocks this out, and the stalling that you see in wild-type cells is partially rescued. Now, it turns out that the reason it's a partial rescue is when ribosomes are forced to translate through this poly-A sequence, they wind up shifting frames. And this is shown in vitro studies from Rachel Green's lab. And so what you wind up is only one third of the polypeptides remain in the right frame, and you get the RFP that's synthesized. But basically, the experiment works exactly like it does in yeast with the HEL2. When you delete this ubiquitin ligase, you get read-through of a sequence that would have caused stalling. Now, we know that it probably did slow down at that poly-A sequence because the ribosomes clearly can't translate that very effectively, and they actually wind up going out of frame. But this phenotype is rescued by the wild-type ligase and not a mutant that's defective in ubiquitination. So you know this ligase has to be active to ubiquitinate something in order to allow ribosomes to stall here. And of course, this acts before the other factors, and that makes sense because you have to stall before you actually split the subunits and degrade the polypeptide. And you can show this doing epistatic analysis. So what you then basically have is in wild-type cells, you slow down quite a bit at poly-A sequences, and then you get eventually, presumably, splitting and ubiquitination by the factors I already told you about. But in a knockout of this ligase, ZNF598, you still seem to slow down there, but eventually translate through perfectly fine. And so how exactly does the ZNF598 convert this slowdown into a terminal stall? So the first thing we wanted to try to do, because we thought it might be a clue to the answer, but it turned out not to be so much, is what is it ubiquitinating? So it turns out that if you mix purified ZNF with native ribosomes isolated from reticulocyte lysate, and then you add E1, E2, ubiquitin, and so on, and the ubiquitin is tagged, you can then see, if you isolate the ribosomes denature and purify via the tagged ubiquitin, what's ubiquitinated. I mean, this is a remarkably clean experiment for one of these kind of experiments, but you basically get these two bands along with some faint smear, and if you treat this sample with a deubiquitinase, these two bands collapse to a single band, which when you identify it turns out to be the ribosomal protein ES10. So ES10 appears to be the main target on the ribosome for this ligase, and it's monoubiquitination at one of two sites. Okay? And you can see here that when you knock out the ligase, the little bit of ES10 that's getting ubiquitinated under normal conditions is gone. Now, if you incorporate into the cell versions of ES10 in which the ubiquitination sites are mutated, you can partially rescue the stalling, you can partially prevent the stalling that occurs. Okay? So that tells you that it partially phenocopies the phenotype of the ligase deletion. And that means that you need the ubiquitination on the ribosome to somehow stall the ribosome at the poly-A tail. As I said, this didn't really tell us what was going on. And I should mention that actually very similar observations were made by Eric Bennett's lab, Nahum Sonnenberg, and in working in yeast, the Inada lab, in which ubiquitination on the ribosome somehow allows these downstream events to occur. And actually some really nice work from the Inada lab has identified genetically some factors that seem to get, that use this ubiquitin as a mark, but what they do we don't really know. But it doesn't really tell us how this ligase identifies slow-moving ribosomes in the first place to put this mark there. And that's the last couple experiments I'll tell you about. So a clue came when we looked very carefully at some of our experiments. One should always look carefully at your experimental results, but sometimes you don't. So when we were trying to identify the sites on the ribosome that are ubiquitinated by this ligase, we of course wanted to make sure that the sites were actually on the ribosome. So the experiment that we did preliminarily was to do this mixing with the ligase, ubiquitinate it, and then analyze the products on a sucrose gradient. And what you can see is that here's just blotting for ribosomal proteins. This is where the monosomes are. And then this is blotting for ubiquitinated products, which turn out to be ubiquitinated ES10. And you can see that they don't quite migrate in the same fractions as where the ADS monosomes are, and neither does the ligase, the ZNF. So that was a little bit weird, and we chalked this up to a blotting artifact for quite a while, but you know, you keep seeing the same thing over and over again, and you say, and you realize that actually there's something a little bit odd happening here. And so what we thought was happening is that when you take native polysomes from a lysate and you treat them with nuclease, you then generate monosomes, but if there are ribosomes that are very close together, they might be resistant to nuclease digestion, and those would potentially be ubiquitinated by this ligase, and that would explain why the fractions are deeper in the gradient, why they're bigger, okay? And the reason this was of some interest was, at the same time, we were talking to somebody who had just joined Venki Ramakrishnan's lab, Vish Chandrasekharan, and he was very interested in polysomes. And so thinking about polysomes and our interest in how slowing of ribosomes is actually sensed led us to this idea that when ribosomes are very close together, that could be an indicator that the front ribosome has slowed down enough for the trailing ribosome to catch up. And this was kind of an interesting idea, so we decided to pursue this. So can we actually induce this? And by this time, we had learned a number of tricks in the translation field, and the experiment was the following. So, of course, if you treat cells with a translation inhibitor, what happens is you just inhibit all the ribosomes from moving, you have polysomes, nothing exciting happens. And if you look at where the ZNF ligase is in sucrose gradients of lysates from these cells, it's at the top of the gradient, and this is where ribosomes and polysomes are, monosomes and polysomes, and nothing changes. What this actually tells you is stalling of the ribosome isn't actually a cue for recruiting ZNF. Every ribosome is stalled here, but nothing happens. But if you treat with very low doses of this inhibitor, and it turns out it has to be specifically an inhibitor that binds but has a slow off rate, and emetine is essentially irreversible, what you wind up doing is hitting the occasional ribosome before you target the ribosomes behind it, and some of them will catch up. And now you get recruitment of the ZNF to these ribosomes. I mean, it's an amazing experiment, right? And so you do the same experiment, but now you look at ubiquitination, and in the sub-inhibitory concentrations of emetine, you get ubiquitination, but at high concentrations, you don't get ubiquitination. And this correlates with the recruitment. And it doesn't have anything to do with the conformation of the ribosome, because if you use other inhibitors that work by totally different mechanisms, you get very similar effects, right? Where you get ubiquitination preferentially when you have sub-inhibitory concentrations. So the idea then was that you're getting this stacking of ribosomes here, and that would be kind of nuclease resistant. So to have more control over the experiment than just kind of titrating in random amounts of inhibitor, we did a more sophisticated experiment where we took native polysomes in reticulocyte lysate that are translating hemoglobin. And we then finished translation, but in the presence of a mutant of eukaryotic release factor 1 that cannot hydrolyze the peptidyl tRNA. Okay, so for the aficionados, which actually in this room is a lot of them, it's an AAQ mutation in the GGQ motif. So that binds at the point of termination, but it can't terminate efficiently, at least on some of the ribosomes, and the guys behind it will pile up. And then we can see whether ZNF gets recruited and ubiquitinates. And what you can see is that compared to, for example, acute treatment with emetine, which just stalls all the ribosomes, the ERF1 mutant results in increased ubiquitination of this ES10 protein. So we then can nuclease digest this sample before treating with ZNF. And what you can see is that when you analyze these samples on a sucrose gradient, here's where the majority of ribosomes are. This is the monosome peak here because it's been nuclease digested. So anything that didn't stack up gets converted to monosomes. But in the polysome fraction, primarily I think disomes here, but the small population where this ERF1 trick worked, you have material that's nuclease resistant, i.e. it's still in a polysome of some size, and almost all of the ribosomes there are ubiquitinated. So you can really nicely separate the ubiquitinated population. And one can go one step further where from this trick you can separate the ribosomes by size. And then, even though the fractionation's not great, you can isolate the monosomes versus disomes, trisomes, and so on, and you can see that the ubiquitination activity of this ZNF ligase is clearly much better towards the stacked ribosomes. So not only does it recognize and bind these stacked ribosomes, but that's what it prefers to ubiquitinate. And finally, these, of course, are artificial tricks. But one can translate in vitro a poly-A containing polypeptide, and then affinity purify that ribosomal complex, separate it on a gradient, and see where the ZNF is. And the ZNF there, even though the majority of translated polypeptides are monosomes, and that's because in this in vitro system, you don't get very many rounds of multiple initiation. The system basically just dies after one round of translation. But the little bit that you get that stalls that's the population that seems to preferentially recruit the ZNF. So the majority of the nascent chains are here, but the ZNF is deeper in the gradient. So to summarize then, what I think is going on, and I realize, of course, I don't have a final answer of everything, but I think this is a very important insight into what's happening. During normal translation, of course, you have polysomes in which the ribosomes initiate, and it's clearly not uniform in terms of the translation. So occasionally you'll get a transient slowdown. And if that slowdown allows the ribosome to restart or translate far enough away so that the next ribosome reaches the slow point before it bumps into it, nothing happens. But if the slowdown is severe enough so that the trailing ribosome bumps into it, then you have this very specific event, which we believe is the target for recruitment of ZNF. Now, we have no idea exactly where ZNF is going to bind, but I've drawn it at the interface between the two because that's the unique feature of these collided ribosomes. And there's very nice cross-linking experiments from Naum Sonnenberg's lab in which they see ZNF cross-links to a variety of different parts of the ribosome that really don't make that much sense, and to tRNA, but only the 5' side of the tRNA. And we think that that would fit with this position because it also cross-links to mRNA. And an advantage of this position is it explains, if the two ribosomes are very close together, a unique site for ZNF recruitment. It also explains why these are nuclease resistant in our biochemical assays. And we think that this complex is stabilized by this recruitment because, of course, biochemically, we can isolate it very easily. And somehow, and we don't understand this, the addition of ubiquitin appears to further stabilize this complex. And what's attractive is that the ZNF, I didn't tell you anything about its domain structure, but it does have a domain, these zinc fingers, that are known to be capable of binding ubiquitin-like domains. So what's very attractive is after it ubiquitinates the ribosome, it then can stabilize itself on the ribosome, but it's certainly entirely plausible that additional factors are recruited. But once you stabilize this, now the splitting factors can eventually outcompete potential translation factors. So if you give these splitting factors enough time, because it's an irreversible reaction, it will eventually split this ribosome. And so what we think might happen is that once you turn a transient pause into a permanent stall, you then split, presumably the leading ribosome, and the large subunit recruits these ubiquitination factors, and the ubiquitin, which we posit is on the trailing ribosome, just based on where on the ribosome the ubiquitin is attached, where the ES10 protein is. That marks this ribosome as having something wrong with it. So again, this is speculative, but it's completely consistent with all of the data that I've shown you. And I think it now provides a very nice framework for trying to address the mechanisms by which the ubiquitin is interpreted and the mechanism by which the ZNF actually binds and is recruited and so on and so forth. So I'm gonna stop there, and I just wanna mention, I've tried to mention people's name along the way, but I'll highlight Susan Chow, who's now an assistant professor at Harvard, for really doing the biochemical reconstitution that I talked about in the first half of the talk, and Shimon Yuskovich is a graduate student that's currently in the lab, and he did all the work on the ZNF ligase and its mechanism of action. And we've had a number of fantastic interactions with Venki Ramakrishnan's lab, in particular, Alan Brown, who helped us a lot, helped Susan a lot with the structural analysis, and as well as the EM facilities at the LMB. Thank you.
Take questions?
Terrific talk. Do you know, and I'll tell you why I asked this in a second, whether a collision can be sensed as a 40S, 80S collision. And the reason I ask this is several years ago when we were studying nodular decay, we had the hypothesis of collisions, and we put a very strong stop just downstream of an AUG, because if you required a collision,
right,
you should never get one. And we still got good cleavage.
Right. So it's an excellent question, and we have done some experiments. So I can't answer your question specifically, but we have done some experiments as well as, I think, similar experiments in the Greyhack lab, where you put the poly A near the 5' end of the message, and you still get the quality control. We don't know exactly how efficient it is compared to downstream, but it's no longer dependent on this ligase. And so I like that experiment a lot, because the idea was to put very little space for another ADS to sit there. And so that's another piece of argument against or for this idea.
So you also have ASK1 or RAC1, which is important in this process. I wonder whether you have evidence that is also acting as a sensor on the 40S for stalling and bumping each other and so on.
Yeah, no, it's a great question. I think my slides are gone, but basically the we think that based on the position of where the ASK1 is, there are two ideas. The simplest is that it recruits the ubiquitin ligase or facilitates recruitment of the ubiquitin ligase. And I think that's probably the simplest idea. The other is that it does something more elaborate based on its signaling capacities. But the problem is that the ASK1 is essential, and we've essentially not done anything to be able to manipulate it. And so that's partly why we haven't, don't have anything intelligent to say about it.
I should just mention we do have microphones here, so if you have questions, please make use of them. So.
I'm over here. A recent paper, I think it was in Cells, showed that also the conjugation machinery for UFM1 is present at the ribosomes and seems to target, so by UFM emulation, many of the same subunits as you have shown for ZNF598. I think you are aware of that paper. And do you think there's any relation there, any crosstalk between those modifications?
So I wasn't aware of that study. But if there is another modification that occurs on the exact same sites, it could be a very interesting way of, for example, making those ribosomes resistant to this mechanism. Yeah. And that might be very useful because there are certainly cases in vivo where you may want very strong stalls in translation, but to not have them recognized. So that would actually be extremely interesting to investigate. Yeah.
If I understand your model correctly, then one would imagine that depending on the sort of severity of the stall, that sort of with intermediate severity, there's a certain chance that a ribosome may or may not catch up, which is influenced also by the initiation rate.
That's right.
Have you tested that kind of scenario?
So we've tested some aspects of it. So we've certainly varied the poly A length, and you get a very simple graded response. So what we had thought was that there would be a sharp cutoff. So if there was a cutoff, then that would be inconsistent with this model, but we get a very graded response consistent with the stochastic reading through. And similarly, if you change the AAA to AAGs, you get a very subtle engagement of this pathway, and that's consistent with AAGs only causing a partial slowdown in translation as opposed to a much stronger slowdown. In terms of changing the rate of initiation, we've just started such experiments, and if you have any good ideas, I'm certainly open to them, but we've tried essentially either fiddling with things like the Kozak sequence or putting UORFs to try to change the rate at which you initiate on the open reading frame, because I think that's an important prediction of the model.
I'm wondering if you ever look what happened at which stage the tRNA became deaminoxylated, because it looks like it's stuck in the ribosome by ubiquitination. So is there some factor and why it's like an unusual mechanism to keep it in there?
Why you keep the polypeptide in the ribosome with the tRNA?
Why you don't deaminoxylate tRNA, because
that's
the usual way to recycle it.
That's right. I think that the main reason I think it keeps it on the ribosome is because once you release the polypeptide, then you have to count on it being unfolded and being recognized by other pathways. And there are many instances where, for example, if you happen to stall at a domain boundary, then you've made one domain, it might be folded just fine and act as dominant negatives. So this way, you essentially force the polypeptide to be degraded independently of folding status. Because if you haven't completed the protein, the assumption is something is wrong with the polypeptide. But that's a purely hand-waving argument. Yeah, so the downstream step, we don't think it's spontaneous deacylation, but the mechanism is totally unclear. So I didn't go into, so this pathway has many, many other facets that I didn't discuss. But there's a factor called CDC48 that's needed downstream of this. And there's another factor called RQC1, and exactly what they're doing is totally unclear. But there are steps that need to happen afterwards.